the awkward money topics you should be talking about with your partner and with your children, and how to bring them up. We are joined today by the legendary Brian Tracy and his daughter, Dr. Christina Stein, to demystify the awkward topics of money and sex, methods to overcome power struggles in your relationship, and things you can do to raise highly successful children.
Values are something you can't just sort of assume that they will materialize. Values are something that are important. You need to talk about them. You need to think about them. You need to discuss, well, what does it mean? What does equality mean? What does freedom mean? And so on.
So I think it's finding the balance in that space where maybe your partner is not making as much money as you are, but he still gets to be in charge in some way or another so that he feels like he can tap into that masculine role in the relationship.
Brian Tracy needs no introduction as the best-selling author and thought leader in the fields of personal development. And Dr. Christina Stein is a speaker, author, and a psychotherapist who runs a private practice in Santa Monica focusing on work-life balance and female empowerment. Brian and Christina are the co-authors of the book Believe It to Achieve It. And I'm your host, Kiana Danial, the founder of the Invest Diva Movement, the march to jump on, to take control of your financial future, and to make your money work for you. My mission is to help 1 million moms start investing on their own by the year 2025. So if you are a mom and or if you know of other moms who could benefit from taking control of their financial future, please spread the word and help us make this huge impact. The best place to start is learn.investdiva.com/yes. We're going to cue in the intro and let's go say hi to Brian Tracy and Christina Stein. So excited to have you guys here. You are just like this bundle of wisdom and I can't stop like listening to you guys. You're awesome. I love your book. You guys have to go and grab this book, Believe It and to Achieve It, because I know you might have read, I don't know, if you're watching this channel, you probably have read a variation of this, but it's just reinforcement of the same idea over and over again. Cause you know, our brain just works so hard in the background that you forget about it. Like I personally forget about it. So I have to read over and over again so that I bring myself back to the habit of believing what my future wants to look like. But today we are going to talk about something that is a little bit more awkward. And that is talking about money to your partner, whether you're married or is your boyfriend or fiance. I think I want to gear it more towards married couples, especially if you haven't talked about money in detail before getting married, and it now gets even that much harder to bring it up. So, Christina, I know that you are just like the guru when it comes to this. So, what are some of the questions that people should be talking about in their marriages?
Well, you know, it's interesting because you quote it as awkward questions, right? And I know we tie it a little bit, sex and money are both a little bit of awkward subjects because sometimes you don't grow up with language around either of these. So when you get into a relationship with a partner, it's so important to try to understand what their values are on how they spend money and what their attitudes are about saving and where they want to invest in terms of overall life. One of the things that I come up against a lot in my practice and working with couples is one person feels that it's really important to spend money on material items and, you know, a nice home, a nice car, watches, jewelry, things like that. And the other person is really more excited about investing and spending money on.
That's me and my husband. Literally, my husband likes to spend. I like to invest. All right, go on. What should I talk to him about? I'm getting a free session, couple therapy.
And so it's really important to understand that as not right and wrong, but as a difference, right? You know, like it's a different value system. And so it's about finding a balance between the two so that you're saving and you're you're buying material items or investing in things that are solid, but you're also having experiences and making memories and spending money on those kind of things. And I think it's also really important to talk about expectations in a relationship, because oftentimes one partner is making more money than the other partner, and it can often become a power struggle, the same way sexual desire in a relationship can become a power struggle. And so talking about what the balances and the expectations are around, you know, who's making money and how each person is contributing to the relationship as a whole.
So I have a lot of questions here. So the power struggle is real. How would you address, let's say, a man's ego? And I know we have Brian over here, but let's say that there is a woman who actually makes a lot of money and contributes. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to hurt the man's ego. And it's not a kind of, I'm not talking about myself, actually. My husband's very supportive. But I know of women whose husbands would actually get very intimidated if the wife is making more money. And I think it might have to do with their upbringing. We're not putting anybody down. But how would you handle such situations so that it doesn't become a power struggle? Whereas if it's about money or even sex or anything else?
Well, you know, traditionally, like if you look into, you know, traditional relationships and historically, men, the identity of men has often been like protector, provider. And so as women are much more capable and providing and in the, you know, in the workforce earning a lot, oftentimes more money than their partners, it does sort of shift that identity for men who associate with that protector-provider perspective. My experience is that it needs to be defined. And so, and one of the challenges too is that like women who go into like a corporate job and are, you know, have to take on that alpha role or be in charge, when they come home, they want to come home to a husband who can take over that role, and then they can tap into their feminine selves. And so I think it's finding the balance in that space where maybe your partner is not making as much money as you are, but he still gets to be in charge in some way or another so that he feels like he can tap into that masculine role in the relationship.
So basically women have to put down two hands.
You know, I actually think it's more of a negotiation.
Yeah.
You know, it's about addressing sort of that insecurity, but it's also highlighting the value that each person is bringing into the relationship.
So right? Talking about the value, appreciation, I think that is the key.
Yes. Yeah. I often talk about it as like an equitable exchange, right? So you're both contributing to the relationship, and it's not apples to apples, but it's apples and oranges. And you have to identify what that is so that both people feel like they're playing an active, important role in the relationship.
Right. So no, that's absolutely true. So for people who are not married and they're thinking of, you know, they're already engaged, what are some of the questions that they should be asking each other?
Well, definitely, you know, what their hopes are in terms of, you know, planning to earn money, attitudes around traditional versus non-traditional roles around money, right? So if you come together with a person and you've decided you want to be a stay-at-home mom and marry someone who's going to provide for you, then that's a conversation that needs to happen in the beginning, because that's an expectation and that's a value system that both people have to kind of agree to, or even having a plan where, you know, you take turns being the major earner, or you find a balance with having kids or whether you want to have kids. And then also, you know, as I mentioned before, the idea of how you spend money. You know, do you save money? Do you spend money? What do you spend money on? Who is in charge of finances? Who's better at it? Those kind of
things. Yeah. So it's very interesting. So when it comes to my students, I find that a lot of them are like, yeah, we don't even talk about money because it's kind of taboo. It's like, they don't even want to bring it up. Like what would be a conversation opener if there's a couple that really struggles, like traditionally talking even about money or even about sex? Like both of them are, these are conversations, like even like 10 years into marriage, like you still haven't talked about your favorite position. I don't know. I'm sorry. So it's like your dad is here.
It's very true. And it's crazy to think about, because we spend money every day, and every couple has some kind of sexual activity between the two of them. And yet to not speak about it, it's like, you know, we talk about food all the time, and that's a comfortable conversation, but talking about sex and money, which are equally prevalent, are very hard to talk about. You know, I find that sometimes it's easy to broach those subjects if it's done, you know, with a prompt, you know, or as a game or from a book. As I think I mentioned to you earlier, there's a book called 8 Dates by the Gottmans, who are, you know, a very well-known couple. They're a couples therapist. And it's just basically a series of questions that you go through in different areas of a relationship so that you can bring it up as a third party sort of outside of the couple. And here's some questions that we can explore and play with these ideas so that it doesn't feel so serious and intimidating.
Awesome. We're going to add a link to that book to this video as well. Thank you so much, Christina, for your answers. I know these are topics that are incredibly awkward, even in the today's date, that like we're kind of like everywhere you go, you're hearing about sex, you're hearing about money, but still when it comes to your own family, it's a very, very hard conversation to have. I also watched one of your videos, Christina, where you were talking about the importance of talking to your kids about sex and sexuality early on. And I loved it. And you probably will say better, but you were saying that it's better to talk about sex before they're 12 or before they kind of hit that desire so they don't hear it from somebody else.
Yes.
So they feel comfortable talking about it to you. So it's not only the conversation between you and your spouse, is like you have to talk about, like, to this day, I don't think like I could ever talk about sex to my dad, my mom maybe, I don't know. So what is the question that you would ask your child about sex or talk about sex?
You know, I look for teachable moments. So especially things in, you know, kids are watching TV shows or they're reading stories or they're seeing people or, you know, they watch me and my husband kiss and make a comment or an observation. And so those are opportunities, I feel like, where you can sort of talk about healthy relationships and connections between people and what that means. And then in addition to that, you know, just talking about how your bodies change. So I have an 8-year-old, an 11-year-old, and a 13-year-old. So it's nice because I can sort of point out the different ages of my kids to the other kids and we talk about things. But in talking about, you know, I have to talk to my 13-year-old before she gets to this place of not knowing what's going on with her body. And so, you know, just sort of bringing up things that are day to day and making it really normal and easy to talk about, not, you know, especially talking about our own physical experience so that we're normalizing it to them.
So I obviously have a question for Brian here. Did you and your wife talk about sex with Christina?
Well, with Christina, we used to joke. They called her the Dr. Ruth of her grade school. Because, she was fascinated with sexuality from a very young age. And we have always been completely open with our children. There's been no secrets or anything. So Christina could ask any questions at all, and she would read a lot, and she would talk about it, and she would teach her friends and so on. So it was normal and natural. But there's something I wanted to comment on. When my wife and I got together, I am 9 years older than my wife. I had more work experience, more income experience, didn't have that much money, and my wife had less. But I had two values with regard to that, and one was equality, is that no matter what, is Barbara and was equal to me in every sense. And the other was freedom, is that I wanted Barbara to be free with regard to money or anything else. So therefore, 100% of everything that we had or did was wide open. And so I have never questioned any expenditure that Barbara's ever made. And I have earned, unfortunately, I earned a lot of money over time. And she has been responsible for decorations in the house, redoing the pool, a lot of expensive things. But she has known that she could do any of these things because I completely trusted her and her good common sense. And I think Barbara can tell you that. There's never been a question. She could do whatever she wanted to do. And I supported her 100% because I wanted her to feel free and equal. And so it's a good place to start, is what are the values, the fundamental values that are going to guide our relationship together? And values are something you can't just sort of assume that they will materialize. Values are something that are important. You need to talk about them. You need to think about them. You need to discuss, well, what does it mean? What does equality mean? What does freedom mean? And so on. And by keeping this conversation ongoing, we just had this conversation last week about Barbara has never made an expenditure in her life that I've ever questioned. Whatever she decides to do with money, I support her 100%. And that's really important. It's really important that each member of the couple feels completely accepted in the decisions they make with regard to money.
That needs a lot of trust within the couple, yes, as well, which I think if you don't have the conversations beforehand, the trust is kind of harder to achieve. Because I hear this a lot, like even on my YouTube videos or everywhere else, I see in the comments, like, if only I could stop my wife to spend so much, I would be richer.
Uh-huh.
I hear that a lot.
Yeah.
And I can really like feel it right now. People listening to this are going to say, well, you probably didn't care because you had money. I don't have money, so I don't want my wife. So I think they should go see Christina and see couple therapy.
Well, I want to add something, actually. I think what you're saying is really true, where it's frustrating when the plan is not bought in by both parties, right? Like I think freedom and you know, it being equal partnership is incredible, and that's what you strive for. But in order to get to that place, I think there has to be a conversation around how are we as a team going to spend our money, and why do we have to save certain money, and let's have shared goals towards our saving, towards our expenses. And both people have to buy into the plan, or at least understand the plan. Because if one person declares this is how it's going to be, that's when you get the other partner not listening or not choosing to buy in and spending whatever they want, because they're not as committed, because they don't feel like they're a part of the team when it comes to this plan.
That's super important. Yeah. So you cannot just go and say, hey, don't spend. That literally leads into the power struggle we talked about earlier, yes, that you want to avoid by all means, because that is not going to end early and beautifully, right? That's going to end ugly.
Yeah.
100%. Christina, Brian, is there anything else you wanted to add to this particular topic?
Yes. Here's something that's very important. At the beginning of each of my seminars, and I've done now more than 5,000 seminars around the world for more than 5 million people. And I often start off my seminars and I say, you become what you think about most of the time. So what is it that you think about most of the time? I also say, you become what you read. You become what you teach. You become what you think about most of the time. So one of the things that I discovered is that in successful companies, couples financially, the one or both will spend as much as 10 hours per month reading about money. And what does this mean? Is they read books on financial success and financial planning. They read magazines on the subject and they discuss them. And they go back and forth. And what do you think about this? And what do you think about that? So both members of the couple are growing in their understanding of money, understanding how important it is to save, how important it is to have money put aside, how important it is to plan for the future, how important it is to insure, and things like that. And so the couple is constantly growing together. and constantly talking about financial matters so that they stay equal, they stay parallel. And this has been very important to us in my family and with my wife, is that we talk about money a lot of the time, so that we are never upset or angry or anything about money.
That's super important. So I guess, again, people, read this with your spouse, right? It will be a conversation opener, because you'll be on the same page. I think that's a great advice, because, like, oftentimes, and I see that with my husband as well, like, we have completely different interests. So he reads his own books, I read my own books, and then we don't often, I mean, we try, but our interests are so different that we don't get together and talk about it. But I feel like what you just said makes a lot of sense, to find something and talk about it and kind of get on the same page when it comes to a topic that you are passionate about and is causing trouble in your relationship.
Christina is very knowledgeable about the question, how do you think about money? As I recall, Christina has had a lot of experience in this area. So I wouldn't jump in, but I would open it up to Christina, because you had a couple of questions about money when you were younger too.
Well, I think that it's been interesting learning about money and spending money and attitudes and conservative views on spending money versus sort of the more practical aspect of it. You know, I know that in some families and some cultures that it's very shameful to ask people about their money or how much they're earning, or, you know, you don't tell people how much money you have. Whereas there are other families and cultures where discussing money is very open and it's more of a tool to accomplish things. And so the shame is taken out of it and it becomes a much more open dialogue. And, you know, I've obviously learned that as growing up, but also in my experience with working with so many couples and in my practice. So, yeah.
What you just said, that's exactly what it is. Money is just a tool, you guys. Money is not bad or evil or good or anything else. It's just a tool. And what you just said, that some families talk about it openly. Sadly, I feel like people who have actually achieved wealth are the ones who talk about money more. And it is more of a taboo among families that don't have money, that they don't want to talk about it. And I feel like in order to actually turn things around and gain the money that you actually desire, you have to start the conversation around it. You cannot just avoid a topic and then expect it to magically appear in your life. You have to talk about it. You have to declare. You have to decide when in Brian's words, that you actually wanted you. And then that is how you can achieve it. So you guys, you heard them. You heard from the best, literally. Talk about money, believe that you can get it, and talk about it with your spouse, no matter how awkward it is, and talk about sex too. So thank you guys so much for joining. This was the second of our three kind of trial with Brian and Christina. I'm like just super thankful for you guys for getting the time, putting in your calendar and joining us. In the next episode with Brian and Christina, we're going to talk about why working hard doesn't always lead into success and money. Yep. So we're going to talk about that in the next episode. You guys, if you like this video, if it was informative to you, share it with your spouse, with your children. Let this be the conversation opener that you want to have in your family. And of course, subscribe, like, and comment. And I'll see you in the next episode of the Invest Diva Movement.